what inspired you to actually dive into this? I mean, it's we've had Hereafter, you had Clint Eastwood try it. You've had other people. I mean, it's a topic that's been there. Your version is extraordinary, but I'm curious as to what you how you started down that road.
It's funny you mentioned the Clint Eastwood film because I once had a meeting with Frank Marshall. And I was in LA doing the pre-visualization for the tsunami scene. Mm-hmm. And he was coming from the pre-visualization of the tsunami scene in the Clint Eastwood film. and he got late and he told me, I was just watching this storyboards for the Clint Eastwood scene in the tsunami. I'm exactly doing the same here in LA. So it was quite funny. The thing is that the producer, Renata, I heard the story on the radio, and she was very impressed about it, she told me, and from the very beginning, it was like an obsession. I mean, I think it's the story, right?
So did you work from
there? The idea is that Bayona didn't go out to try and find a story to tell about
the tsunami.
The tsunami. He didn't set out to tell us to make a movie about the tsunami. The story found him, really. And it was a very specific, honest, true story about the tsunami.
And the family was the core of that. Mm-hmm. Did you?
Yeah, it's like we try to be as much faithful as possible because that was the way of trying to be honest, try to pay respect for what happened. Mm-hmm. We had a great sense of responsibility, and we were very lucky that the family was with us working on the project.
So was it that part easy? Was that difficult? I mean, what was the process of writing the script and going through all that with them?
It was a long, long process. I mean, we worked together, Sergio, the writer, with Maria, and it was also Belen there, so we were having meetings and tried to figure out what was the best way to tell the story. And at the end, it was a question of telling the story of this family and using the family to tell the story of all the people who was there. And and try to get into the minds of these people and see the whole thing through their eyes.
So did you know what a challenge creating this tsunami would be?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we were writing the script and at the same time we were preparing that scene because it took us like a year of research to try to figure out how we were going to do that. Oh my God, my English.
No, it's good.
And how did you start to put the cast together?
Well, it was from the very beginning it was Naomi and Ewan. I mean, from mm-hmm. the very beginning.
So how did it come to you, Ewan?
I'm trying to remember how it went. I was sent Bayona's movie, The Orphanage, I think before I was sent the script, or I may have been sent them together. But anyway, I'd seen The Orphanage and I really liked it. Mm. And so I was very interested in him as a director. And then when I read the script, I read it without knowing that it was a true story or that I read it sort of cold, if you like. And it's, as the movie does, it just totally grabs you. There's some incredible honesty about it. The dialogue is, I thought the time was just extraordinarily well written, and of course, Sergio's an amazing writer, but also some of the lines of dialogue are lines of dialogue that the family remember saying or remember hearing being said. And so, there's something about it that grabs you and drew me in, and I had to be, you know, the combination of the script working with you, and also I felt for me it was the first time in my career that I would explore being a father, being a dad, and I've been a dad for 16 years, but I may have had kids in a film, but I've never done a film about that.
Right.
Special, unique bond that you have with your kids. So for me, those three things were, I was in.
So
where
do
I sign up?
They just didn't think of you for that, or?
I think up until now, I just looked incredibly young. No, I just wasn't old enough, I suppose, for people to think, although I was a dad, people didn't, you know, think of me as in the dad role till sort of recently. Which,
well, you are this, like, you know, the movie Cool. You know, people think of you as the cool guy or the,
right,
you know,
great,
sexy guy or the...
I want to be the sexy, cool dad
guy.
Yeah.
Well, I think Hugh Grant got those parts for
did
a while.
He?
Yeah. Now it's time for you.
Oh,
you're
dear.
The new Hugh Grant.
Okay.
Or the old Ewan McGregor.
I don't
or something
know
like
quite
that.
What to say about that, so I won't say anything.
And how did this young man join you in this journey?
Well, when I first heard about the film, I was in Billy Elliot, and I was getting ready to leave and go back to school and stuff. Mm. And
in LA, in London or New York?
London, I was in London. And Bayona saw me on YouTube, a clip of me on YouTube, and came to London to meet me. And we had like 3 or 4 meetings where we connected really well and we worked very well together. And then in the space of like 6-7 weeks, I was in Spain in a water tank. The process was so quick. Literally, I left Billy and then 6 weeks later, I was in Spain, so.
So what do you need from this young actor to make this work for you?
I mean, he did such a brave job. I mean, he's like, he was dealing with lots of thoughts, very dark thoughts all the time during the shooting. And it was, every day was very intense. When you were talking about before the challenges, probably the biggest challenge was how to find the tone of the film. Because it had to be very extreme. And one of the things I remember is that we never thought, the characters never thought about what is happening because they don't have time to, they don't have time to think about mm-hmm. it. So it should be very emotional all the time. So we had to, we wanted the audience to get into the mind of these people, and the emotion was so extreme that we had to play it like or very low or very high. So we went to mm-hmm. complete silence to big noise or the sound of the orchestra, you know, playing mm-hmm. very, very loud, because that's how the emotion worked. I mean, that scene in the bus station where he collapsed, the character mm-hmm. is probably the first time he thinks about the idea that the rest of the family is dead.
Yeah.
The guy didn't have the time to think about it because that was a privilege. He had to keep looking. So the moment he thinks about it, he collapsed. And the emotion had to work exactly like that during the film. So the film starts like a shock. Mm-hmm. And then there is the emotion, but it's a very, very, very loud emotion. And that was definitely the biggest challenge.
Well, early in with Naomi's character, when she's her leg is bleeding and everything, being dragged, I started thinking about the fact that anytime you're injured, you don't really know how much pain you're in until you lay down for a few minutes, and then you can worry about your pain. And that, I think, recurs over and over through the film, ultimately with you and that other scene, and where, you know, nobody has time to think about having a thing stuck through their leg or their arm or whatever. Yeah. But what about him? What did you need for, I mean, were you having a hard time finding a kid? It sounds like you're kind of late in the
process. Yeah, it was the usual story that you're looking, and you cannot find the kid, and suddenly the kid appears. And he was, I mean, the task he did was amazing. You can tell about it.
Yeah, we had...
Because we did that thing with the Billy Elliot. You remember? We were with this coach, and he asked you to do the scene.
Oh, yeah.
Thinking about Billy Elliot.
Yeah, I had to do... Wait, the one with the letter?
Yeah, the one with the letter.
Bayona made me write a letter, like, to my mum, like, as just a sort of, like, to get in the sort of mood of the film. And I remember reading it and starting to cry, and you were filming and stuff. And then you made me sing Electricity.
That was a different test.
Yeah. So we had loads of really weird techniques.
He's making another movie you don't even know about yet.
But the thing is, we didn't actually know what the
thing
film
now,
was
he's
about.
So humble. I mean, what he did in that test, I mean, it's probably the most difficult thing that an actor can do, which is not getting emotional, is to repress the emotion. Mm-hmm. So he was crying, and he had to stop it. So
stop,
he did it like this. I mean, it was like, think about your mommy, Billy Elliot. Do it like that. And then he started to cry. And I was like, what the? And in that moment, I decided that you were going to be the one. But
you
I
still
did
put
like
3-4 more auditions.
Well, I wish I could say I saw you at Billy Elliot, but I don't know which one it was. You know, I don't know which Billy it was that day. It's a strange thing about Billy Elliot.
There's a lot of us now. I think they're on like the 30th Billy or something like that.
Is that right?
Yeah, there's a lot of us now.
Do you have a reunion every year?
Yeah, it's funny.
Do you get a tie?
Yeah, we did the 5th birthday. I did the 5th birthday. And all the Billys came back to do like a grand finale. And we all did this huge number. And some of the Billys were giant.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, and it's really funny. Like, the current Billys really look up to the Billys that were in the show before them. So if I met the 3 Billys now, the original, I'd be like, oh my God, that's the 3 Billys. But if like Billys that were in the show after me meet me, they're like, oh my God, it's Tom. It's really weird. It's like this cycle. It's great.
How brilliant.
So I went to meet them the other day and they're like this big. And I was like, I was never that big. I can't have been that small.
Right.
But yeah, it was really funny.
There's a great documentary actually about Annie.
Yeah.
About all the Annies getting back together, and apparently they do little reunion groupings where they go see each other and they all sing, and you're like, wow, this is surreal. They're singing the songs together after all those years.
But what an experience in your life. I mean, mm-hmm. To have gone through. I mean, how many years were you involved?
I was in the show for 18 months. I was performing for 18 months, and I had to train for 2 years, like before the
before
show.
Before that.
Yeah. So,
so it's a huge chunk of your, it's an incredible experience.
But it's great. It really formed me, to be honest. Like, I got the most amazing training, like the best trainers in the UK. And I met some amazing people.
When I saw the test, I realized that we had to, the bond he had with the mother in Billy Elliot, I thought we had to do exactly the same with Tom and Naomi in this film. He need to think about this mom, like if it was the mom in Billy Elliot or his own mom, because that was what he was thinking about. So the first rehearsal we did, it was like a month before the shooting. I put Naomi and Tom together, and I make them draw each other. And they were like, what? Because I want them to look at each other, to start to laugh. But the thing is that we started doing that, and 7 months later, we were in the set, the last day of the shooting, shooting the last shot for the film. Mm-hmm. And I realized that we definitely did it, because these two people were not what anymore the characters were, Naomi and Tom saying goodbye to each other. It was very, very emotional.
So how was the difference between the physical production and actually getting it done versus the acting, the performances that you had to get in the midst of all that? Is that, I mean, how much of that was you as a director doing stuff underwater and creating that intensity, and how much was actually having to perform while something's smashing you in the arm and leg? And
I remember this story where I was asking Maria where were the lines in the water, and she told me, come on, I mean, I was trying to survive. I didn't say any line. Mm-hmm. I mean, you couldn't talk. But we wrote it in some lines. So I was in the shooting, we did the first take, and Naomi couldn't talk in the whole day. He was like, I couldn't. I said, okay, it's perfect. It's the way it was, so don't worry. So more or less, it was a very physical work. I mean, they tried to survive. I mean, it was quite dangerous. They were very secure, but it was quite dangerous. I remember you almost had an accident.
We were in these like cups that were on rails, and they would go across the water like 20 miles an hour, something like that. Mm. And they were in the tank, and they used to slow down 10 meters towards the end and then stop. And my one didn't stop, it just kept going. And as it got to the end, it sort of slammed shut, and I sort of just jarred my back against the side. But I was fine. Mm. Like 10 minutes later, I was back in the water and we were all good. But
you were so excited that you came out a little bit more than what was secure.
Yeah. So as it was going and it stopped, I sort of like rolled over the top of it and was just hanging on. But it was fine. I was fine. And all the divers were there to save me, so it was fine.
So you were on some sort of track on like a base that you would be dragged through the water by the
huge tank. It was only this deep. So we had to pretend that it was like tens of meters deep. But we were in this thing and we were sort of like strapped in like here. So it was really odd. It was good fun though. And it was really
It sounds fun. Horrifying.
Yeah. I know. I remember.
Naomi was talking yesterday about doing some of the underwater sequences where she was on a chair that she's strapped into that spun around. So she's under the water with a breather, and then they were all right, ready to go. She takes a breather out, does this scene, the chair's spinning round and round, and at the end, she was supposed to unstrap and come up. And as she got to the end, she went to unstrap, and the chair started spinning round the other way.
God.
And she said, you know, you try and do the take for as long as possible because you want the take to be good. So she had no air left, and yet then she couldn't get to the seatbelt because the chair was going round again. Oof. I mean, that kind of stuff is really, anything underwater is really scary to do, even though the water may not be deep. You're in a panicky situation.
When we were doing the bit in the scene when I get hit by the car, and the car was on rails, and I was strapped to the bottom and to the back, and as it came, it would pull me under, and there was a diver there, and I went under and started taking his air, like, just to make sure I was safe, and everyone thought I was supposed to come up. So everyone went, oh my God, get him out! And I had, like, 20 people dive in, like, and I was like, what?
You're going there, like,
everyone was freaking out. I was like, I'm fine!
So is it in your contract that you would miss the tsunami or part of it? You would
hit
at the pool and take off for a week?
I didn't know you shot a tsunami right before us, because I saw the salmon fishing and there is this scene.
There's a bit of a tsunami in that. practice. Yeah. That was my practice. No, it was just always the structure and the script that I thought interesting and really strong structure that you...
Yeah.
You know, you follow Naomi and Tom, and you don't know what's happened to the rest of the family because they don't. And that was very important, I think.
So how much of the universe did you create on set? I mean, is that a lot of that CG'd, or is it...
Well, all of the what's amazing is all of the water is real. You know, you Hotel only wanted to use real water, so there's no CGI created water. There's shots of water that are recreated digitally, but it's all real water, and I think that's what makes it so, you know,
and the sets
panicking.
Were huge.
And the sets were enormous. The devastated area, you know, and you're reading the script and you go walk through the devastated area, and you think, okay. And then you get to set, and someone takes you, and you see a devastated area, and then you're walking and walking and walking and walking and walking before you get to the actual set where you're going to shoot. It was huge, amazing, and very difficult to create, I think, you know, but it looked perfect.
Does it make it easier for you to act, or is it?
Yeah, always. If you're doing all that stuff and surrounded by green screen and stuff, it may be impossible to do it as well as when you're actually in that situation, surrounded by all the debris and like the shot when the helicopter goes over and everything. I mean, it was so horrible to look at. It was so, and also because we'd done quite a lot of research. We'd watched documentaries that had been made and seen lots of really horrible photographs of research photographs of the tsunami and the after effect. So when you were surrounded with that knowledge and then being in that environment, it took you emotionally to exactly where you needed to be, I think.
We wanted all the time to have happy accidents in the set. I mean, I was keep shooting all the time. And when you have a huge set, when you have extras that have been there, when you're surrounded by reality, and you just keep shooting, suddenly things happen, and sometimes are the best moments in the film.
So how do you afford to do that?
I don't know. This morning when I woke up and the premiere was last night, my first thought is, I survive.
I mean, it looks epic, like Gone with the Wind looked epic. I mean,
it was epic, I can tell you. I mean, it was, it's been almost, we started to work on this film like almost 5 years ago. And it was epic. I mean, every day in the set, and we were so unlucky with the weather. We had such a terrible weather, so everything became more tense. And we had also water. We had to deal with very small kids. They were great, but at the end, all the complications, all the difficulties were there. I mean, I remember when I heard the story, one of the first people I called was Guillermo del Toro. And I told him the story, and I was so emotional about the story. And he told me, Bayona will pay for not doing that. Because he was remembering, he remembered James Cameron working on Titanic, and he told me he had the worst experience working in that film, on the difficulties of that film. And Guillermo told me, Bayona will pay for not shooting that.
Well, that was all tank. I mean, that was really tank. That was not even like, he never really got out of the tank that entire time down in Mexico.
Yeah.
He was down there. So are you a research person in general, Ewan?
It depends on what the role is, really, or what the story is. I think you approach every character in a different way. But something like this, you have to learn and understand about it, I think, to know what you're trying to... Because, you know, it's very difficult to get your head around what happened there, just there, never mind the other countries that the tsunami hit. So you had to have an understanding of that. And speaking to people was obviously the best... people who were there and survived, it was the best kind of research to do, because I spoke to a lady in London who lost her husband in the tsunami there, and she also had three daughters, and her story was very similar to mine in the film, as it by chance. But speaking to her about the searching and about the endless walking and finding a safe place for your children so that you can carry on looking. And she sadly found her husband's body in a temple some days later. But the way she described that really helped me, and the way she talked about the there was no sense of time and there was no sense of distance. And she returned to Thailand some years later, and you know, where she'd left her children and where she found her husband's body, she remembered as being hundreds of miles apart, and when she went back, they were very, very close together, and so she talked about that, and that helped me a lot thinking about that the idea that you've really no sense of time or distance, and the level of shock is quite difficult to play, really.
You have
to understand it, I think.
Do you have a sense that she's recovered, or that the family involved here has? Do you recover from something like this, or do you just find a place to put it after a while and
I think
try to
move
on with
your
life.
This is one of the ideas in the story. I mean, it's like, it's not just a two-dimensional survival film where you live or you die. I mean, it's I think one of the beautiful ideas at the end is that there's a lot of suffering in survival. There's not victory in surviving. There's also a lot of suffering, and this is what the whole ending is about. Mm-hmm. How do you put the audience in Thailand and then send them back home, and how do you feel about it, and what do you think about it, and this is the idea of putting the title at the end. It's mm-hmm. not at the beginning; it's at the end, because this is when the impossible starts. Really, I mean, how are you going to live now after all you've been through? I mean. That's one of the ideas. Talking about talking to survivors, mm-hmm. it was definitely that you have a great sense of responsibility, so you need to talk to them. And I remember talking to that guy we talked in Frankie in Thailand. He was telling me their parents died in Thailand, and I asked him, do you think people will get angry if I show the bodies? Mm-hmm. And he answered me, I will be very angry if you don't show the bodies, because this is what the whole tsunami was about. It was just devastation and death. So at the end, you talk to these people because you need like an authority to show mm-hmm. the story the way it was.
But I assume you toned it down a bit from what it must have been.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, we have to do it. I mean, some of the images were too much.
Yeah.
So we decided that, and sometimes there's no learning in these images. So we didn't need to show that.
Well, like you were saying before, I think it's almost impossible to really get your head around something like this. And I think that's one of the fascinating things about the movie is that you constantly kind of go back to this instinctual humanity, and even you get to be purely raw. You know, when you scream out about your brothers being dead.
Yeah.
That's, you know, what a male, you know, that's testosterone, raw testosterone screaming, I think, as much as anything else. And every instinct seems to be about that, not about, even after the tsunami's gone, it just seems to be very raw and instinctual and not, even then, intellectualized. You can't really think too much. Mm-hmm. I guess that was a speech, not a question, but sorry about that.
Some nice nodding shots, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you're right. I mean, for example, if you think about that moment when the kids come together, and it feels like almost like a melodrama with all the music, you know. But the truth is that you need to make the audience feel what they felt. And I remember going to talk to Lucas, the real Lucas, and I asked him, what do you think about this, and what can you tell me about this moment? And he told me it's very easy to explain. It was the happiest moment in my life. So you need the audience to feel that in order to put them into the experience.
Well, you get it with the little blonde boy also that they found, when he's hugging his father and you see those hands around the neck.
Yeah, oh my God, yeah.
You can almost feel them.
Yeah, this is a story that's yet to end, is that the family have never met Daniel since. They've never seen that little blonde boy since then. And they've never met Benstrom, who Tom finds in the hospital. Mm-hmm. They've never seen these people or met them again. Mm. So but those are their names, you know. And I suppose if they see the movie, they'll go, "That's me." And maybe they'll reunite with the family, you know, which would be an amazing story. That would be a great story in itself.
We had a beautiful story. We went to the location, the hospital, that was before the shooting, and we were talking to a doctor. And the doctor remembered Maria. Mm-hmm. And he asked us, how is she now? Oh, she's perfect, oh great. So mm-hmm. we had the impression, the feeling that the story ended there. Mm-hmm. I mean, this guy was taking care of her, and we decided to do the film, we went to the hospital, and now the guy knows that she's fine, so it was beautiful.
So what is the experience like showing this movie to an audience? Is this the first time, I guess, it's been in front of an audience?
I think it was great, because the whole thing was about the experience, I mean, the emotional experience, and the way people is at the end. I mean, I think that even someone told me that two people faint during the screening. I mean, it had to be like that. It had to be an experience. Mm-hmm. Because I mean, I didn't want to put the audience and send them a message, mm-hmm. especially because movie talks about life, and there's no message in life, there's no lesson. I mean, you need mm-hmm. to put the audience there mm-hmm. and let themselves to project in the story. And I think I think we noticed that the experience was working while the screening.
Was there anything easy about making the movie? Was it light at all?
Our experience as filmmakers and the crew and the actors and the cast. Mm-hmm. You know, I think when you're when you're immersed in this story and in the place where it happened, surrounded by a crew who were all affected by the tsunami, and you have to be able to, and it's the Thai perspective on the tsunami. It's very healthy. Mm-hmm. They're very straightforward about the tsunami and what happened, but mm-hmm. they're also very straightforward about the present and the future and living life now. Mm-hmm. And that's what we did. We would immerse ourselves in the sort of horror of what happened there when we mm-hmm. were at work, and then afterwards we would play, you know, and as a crew we would spend the weekends together. We found this great beach bar called Memories that was set up by a lovely guy who lost a lot of his family in the tsunami. Mm-hmm. And he came to America for a short time and then went back and set up a bar called Memories in memory of all his lost relatives. Mm-hmm. And we would inhabit that place on the weekends, and we would live and play, and the crew would be surfing, and there was music and dancing, and there was quite a lot of drinking going on, actually. Shocking. I wasn't involved in that, but there was some.
Only the weekends.
Only the weekends, obviously. but we did. We lived life as well, you know, because I think mm-hmm. you have to. You couldn't sort of, and nor would the Thai people wouldn't want you to. And mm-hmm. So that was how it was. It was a great experience.
How was your drinking experience?
I wasn't drinking. No, I was only 13.
He hadn't started drinking yet.
Remember?
Yeah. I had this guy following me around everywhere I went. Yeah. No, I wasn't drinking. I was just on lemonade and Coke at that time. Coca-Cola as well.
Class A's and lemonade, really. Yeah. He was on.
But we were at the beach a lot. It was great. Yeah.
And in the end, you want the takeaway from this to be whatever the audience that sees it takes away, not something that you've imprinted.
You know, the first time I talked to Simon, the smallest kid, he told me, I think I changed, but I don't know how. So I realized that we had to do like an experience where life would be the same, mm-hmm. but different. And I was thinking, for example, with music, when you do a score, you play the same melody but in different tones. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking maybe some of the ideas could be told with the music. And also the fact that the movie starts with a plane and finishes with the same plane, mm-hmm. and it's completely different. I mean, the way they get to Thailand, the way they leave Thailand, is the same image, but it's completely different. So mm-hmm. we were all the time trying to play with these ideas.
But you don't want the emotional experience for the audience at the end.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
You don't want them to have, you don't want to say, this is what you should feel. You want them to take away, to come up with their own ideas of what they should feel having had the experience.
If you talk to people at the end of the screening, everybody will say different things. That's the good things about movies. I mean, just let the people to project themselves and have their own story.
So that's what you want, that's your goal?
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
And you were pretty satisfied last night, I guess.
It was a great night.